Church, let's stand together as we sing today. He has rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of the Son that he loves. In him we have redemption and the forgiveness of sins. Let's lift our voice this morning as we sing Jesus' victory over death and darkness. Jesus is alive. Sorrow and dead in my sin. lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace. Our Savior displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested. Thank you. You may be seated. There is love that came for us, humble to a sinner's cross. You broke my shame and sinfulness. You rose again victorious. We know his faithfulness, don't we?
Faithfulness none can deny. through the storm and through the fire, there is truth that sets me free. Jesus Christ who lives in me. You are stronger, sin is broken, you have saved me, it is written, Christ is risen, Jesus, you are Lord of all.
No beginning.
No beginning. You're my hope and my defense. You came to seek and save the lost. You paid it all upon the cross. You are stronger, sin is broken. You have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen, Jesus, you are Lord of all.
So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher.
This is our prayer.
So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher.
Yes.
So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher.
You are stronger.
You are stronger. You are stronger. Sin is broken. You have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen.
Christ has risen, Jesus, you are Lord of all.
Let's ask some questions this morning that I think only have one answer. And thank God they do. Let's sing, Is He Worthy?
Do you feel the world is broken?
We do.
Do you feel the shadows deepen?
We do.
But do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through?
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all made new?
We do.
Is all creation groaning?
It is.
But is a new creation coming?
It is.
Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? It is. Is anyone worthy?
Good morning, Soundside Church, and thank you for joining us here by way of video, whether you're on Facebook or YouTube. Thank you so much for tuning in, whether you're part of our Soundside family or a guest or just you stumbled across this by some algorithm. Thank you. Thank you for joining us today. And I'm going to start today's message in a way that might be a little bit unusual, because today's sermon comes with a warning. That's right. Over the course of the next few minutes, some of you may feel targeted. Some of you are going to feel like I'm talking directly to you, or perhaps even preaching at you. Some of you are going to feel like maybe I am betraying a confidence, like I'm talking like something that something from a conversation we've had that I am now using against you publicly. Let me assure you that that is not the case. I do not and will not preach messages aimed at specific individuals. I may hope, I may pray that a particular message connects well with a particular person, but I will not use the sermon to target you personally. I wish I could say I've never done this, but I have. A few times in my 20s as a much younger, less mature pastor, I did do that, and let me tell you, it never, ever turned out well. But the Holy Spirit does target us personally, and he uses the scriptures to do it, which is why I'm actually a little bit reluctant to preach this message today. You see, I know from conversations that we've had that this message will apply directly to some of us. But if you feel that it applies directly to you, please know that it could just as easily apply directly to the person sitting next to you. And if you feel that parts of this message are coming from a conversation that we have had, please know that it could just as easily be coming from a conversation that I've had with literally 100 other people. Because what we're going to talk about today is something that all Christians struggle with. And this is an area where many Christians have chosen to follow culture rather than follow Christ. This message is going to test just how far you are willing to follow Jesus Christ. So if you feel uncomfortable, as some of you will, please do not waste this opportunity by focusing on the messenger. Instead, focus on the message and ask the question, did God really say that? And if the answer to that question is yes, then ask him what he would have you do about it. Because you're not watching this by accident right now. God wants you to be watching this right now, I believe, just as he led me to preach this sermon today. I certainly didn't choose it. 6 months ago, I sensed the Lord leading me to preach a series of messages from Matthew chapter 5, beginning on September 19th, and so the messages went on the calendar. Oddly, a week or two ago, I sensed the Lord leading me to adjust the calendar just a little bit to preach a special message for Halloween last week, which meant that today's message got bumped to today. So if you're sitting there thinking to yourself, of all the times that I could have clicked on a video, of all the times that I could have picked to watch a church message, I had to pick this one. Well, just know that maybe God actually picked this for you. Now, if you're new to Soundside, you're not part of our family, you just kind of stumbled into this video and you're wondering, what in the world is so wrong with this church that the pastor has to start the sermon like this? My answer is, there is nothing wrong with Soundside Church that every church in America doesn't also need to hear. But I have begun this message like this because I love this church. Jason and I, as pastors of Soundside, we love each and every person in this church, and we would never do anything intentionally to hurt anyone here or to damage the fellowship that we have in Christ. You see, the Bible tells us that there are six things that God hates. He hates, well, and then there are seven. Actually, the seventh is what he considers to be utterly detestable. Six things that the Lord hates, and seven are utterly detestable. Well, they are the things that God hates. They are an arrogant face, a lying tongue, hands that spill innocent blood, a heart that creates wicked plans, feet that run towards evil, a false witness, and the seventh, a person who plants seeds of conflict within a community. But if that's what God hates, consider the blessing pronounced by Jesus on those who make peace. Our verse today, our main text for today, is Matthew chapter 5 and verse 9, where the Bible says, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God." Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Hey, let's make some peace today. Or at the very least, let's plant the seeds of peace today. Now, here's what we're going to do, all right? We're going to begin by looking at exactly what Jesus meant when he said this statement, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God." What he meant is a little bit different, I think, from what it appears to be on the surface, but that will help us as we move into the second part of the message, and that is how to find peace for ourselves. And then we're going to conclude the message by asking how we can make peace with others. So, first part of the message, what did Jesus mean when he said, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God"? Well, to begin with, I want you to forget everything you think you know about peacemaking. And instead, I want you to ask this, what is the opposite of peace? Now, this is not original to me, but the opposite of peace is pieces. Easy to remember. The opposite of peace is pieces. It's not war, it's brokenness. Which means that peace is not the absence of conflict. Peace is the presence of joy and harmony and wholeness. Now, if you were to go visit Mars, you wouldn't find war. despite it being named for the Roman god of war, if you were to visit Mars, you wouldn't find war. But you wouldn't find peace either. It's true, there is no conflict on Mars that we're aware of, but nothing thrives, nothing flourishes there, and that is what is required for true peace. It's not agreeing to disagree, it's finding a higher and better cause to agree upon. And that's what Jesus is pointing to when he says that the peacemakers shall be called children of God. This is the blessing. Peacemakers are blessed because they will be called children of God. But when Jesus said this, he was alluding to a passage of scripture that many in his audience would have known well. Unfortunately, it's a passage that many of us do not, because it's found in the Old Testament prophet of Hosea, which is a part of the Bible that we don't often spend a lot of time in. So let me introduce you. For better yet, let me go ahead and tell you just a bit of a story to understand what Jesus' audience would have already known. In Hosea's day, this is a good 700-800 years before Jesus, but in Hosea's day, God's people were divided into two separate warring kingdoms. One was called Judah, the other was called Israel. Now, we don't have time to dive into why they were divided, so let's just say that the division resulted from both kingdoms turning away from the Lord and falling farther and farther away from him. Now, of the two kingdoms, Israel was by far the worst, and God sent the prophet Hosea to them. Now, God often had his prophets communicate the message in strange but memorable ways. And for Hosea, it involved going and marrying a prostitute and then having three children with her that would receive some very significant names. Now, their first child was a boy named Jezreel, and his name referred to a battle that would put an end to the kingdom. The second child was a daughter that they named Lo-Ruhamah, which means no mercy. And it meant that God would no longer show his mercy to that kingdom. The third child was a boy they named Lo-Ami, which means not my people, which was a message from God that he no longer considered this kingdom to be his people and he would no longer be their God. Church, that's brokenness. That is true brokenness. There are pieces, these are pieces that are scattered absolutely everywhere. Not only are God's people separated from each other, but they're also separated from God. But watch what happens next. I want to read to you Hosea chapter 1, verses 10 through 11. God says this after explaining, you're not my people anymore, I'm not going to be your God. But then he says, yet the number of the children of Israel shall be like the sand of the sea, which cannot be measured or numbered. And in the place where it was said to them, you are not my people, they shall be called children of the living God. And the children of Judah and the children of Israel shall be gathered together, and they shall appoint for themselves one head, and they shall go up from the land, for great shall be the day of Jezreel. Oh, that's a picture of peace. What was broken was restored, or would be restored. Now, notice two things, okay? So first, what Hosea prophesied was what Jesus proclaimed, quote, they shall be called the children of God. Second, notice what brought them together. Hosea said, they shall appoint for themselves one head. That is, they will be united by what they have in common, and what they have in common is their king. That king is Jesus. In the Beatitude, Matthew 5, 9, Jesus is announcing that the king is here, and that there is a blessing for those who are willing to turn from all that divides them and instead find their unity in him. I mean, there was a lot that divided the people in Jesus's day. National interests, political opinions, religious convictions, material, financial concerns, not to mention just everyday interpersonal conflicts. But the peacemakers, those were the ones who welcomed the grace of God as more important than any of it. And they eagerly sought the thriving, flourishing peace that only God could provide and that God was providing through his son, Jesus Christ. The peacemakers were those for whom the glory of God and the good of others were more important than their personal pride, reputation, and comfort. Now, to show us that we're on the right track in interpreting this passage of scripture, the Apostle Paul will quote the exact same verse from Hosea when he's working with the Roman church. The Roman church was a church divided by culture and race, but it was a church that needed to learn that each person was equally sinful and each person was equally forgiven by the grace of God through the gift of Jesus. The church was broken, but in Christ, they could have peace. And just as Jesus reached back to that passage from Hosea to talk about what that peace looked like, the Apostle Paul did the same thing. So my question to you is, do you have peace? Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Who are the peacemakers? The peacemakers are the ones that recognize that by the grace of God, they've got something even greater in common, and they're willing to set aside their personal pride, reputation, and comfort for their true King, King Jesus, who binds them together. So I ask you again, do you have peace? Do you have peace? I want to ask that question because we should ask, how can we have peace for ourselves? How can I make peace if I don't have peace? So let's spend a moment talking about how you can have peace for yourself. Please notice that I did not ask, are you at peace with yourself? That's a fine thing. None of us enjoys having internal conflict, but it's not the most important thing. Having peace with yourself. The most important thing is peace with God. Peace with God. Now, the good news is this. If you are a child of God, you have peace with God. God does not merely tolerate you. He loves you. He delights in you. But if we remain in our sins and refuse to yield to Him, we can only ever hope to have God as our enemy. Enter Jesus. Enter Jesus. Okay, Colossians chapter 1, verses 19 through 22 tells us this. For in Him, in Jesus, all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through Him to reconcile to Himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of His cross. And you who were once alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, He has now reconciled in His body of flesh by His death in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before Him. Do you have peace with God? You can never have true peace with yourself if you don't have peace with God. And God Himself has made the way for you to have peace with Him. And that is by sending Jesus to die on the cross in our place, to rise again from the dead so that we can be forgiven of our sins and declared righteous in the sight of God. Now, once you have peace with God, that's when you can have peace with yourself. Once you have peace with God, you have an all-powerful ally in whatever internal conflicts you feel. You could say, I hate myself. God says, but I love you. And my opinion counts a lot more than yours. You say, I'm broken. God says, yes, but I see you as you were meant to be. And I am remaking you as we speak. You say, I have no friends. God says, I will never leave you or forsake you. You say, I'm afraid. God says, I am your shield and your strong fortress. You say, I can't forgive myself. God says, I never asked you to. I have forgiven you in Christ. You see, it isn't until you have peace with God that you can enjoy lasting peace with yourself. And if you're not at peace with yourself, you're certainly not going to be at peace with others, which is where we turn next. How to make peace. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God. Do you have peace? Peace with God? Peace with yourself? If so, you need to learn how to make peace with others. Now, do you remember when I told you to forget everything you thought you knew about peacemaking? This is why. You see, when many of us hear the word peacemaking, we think of a mediator. We think of a third party that is sent in to resolve conflicts. And that's not who Jesus is addressing here. And it's not who He's talking about when He says, blessed are the peacemakers, because He is the mediator. He is the third party. He is blessing those who take advantage of what He has done to make peace between themselves and someone else. And that's going to be really hard because it means that if we're not talking about peacemakers as the third party, it means that if we are peacemakers, we are one of the aggrieved parties. It means we've either been hurt by someone else or we have hurt someone else. That makes peacemaking a lot more difficult. And if we have hurt someone else, we still probably don't think that we have done anything wrong, which puts peace a little out of reach. Thankfully, Jesus tells us how to handle this. What do you do when you have hurt someone else? Well, we're going to talk about this, and we're going to talk about what happens when they hurt you. But both are necessary to understand if we're going to understand what it means to make peace. So what do you do when somebody has, or what do you do when you discover that you have hurt someone else? Well, Jesus tells us what to do in Matthew chapter 5, verses 23 through 24. He says this, quote, "So if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother, then come offer your gift." Hey, church, we don't have altars today. But Jesus' point is clear, isn't it? It is more important to reconcile a relationship than to offer a sacrifice to God. The moment you become aware that you might be responsible for damaging a relationship, restoring that relationship becomes your top priority. You say, well, what if I'm in the middle of my Bible reading and my prayer time? Shouldn't I finish that first? What did Jesus say? he said that even if you are in the very act of worshiping God, you should stop doing that and go reconcile the relationship. It becomes your top priority. You say, is there nothing more important? Well, if you can think of something more important than worshiping God, maybe that's a candidate. But Jesus says, if you are worshiping God and remember that there's a broken relationship, stop worshiping God, go fix it. It's that important. So, here's a few tips. If you realize that you have hurt someone else, remember, I'm going to give you, one, two, three, four, five, six tips. Tip number one, remember that even if the other person doesn't bring it to your attention, you are still responsible to reconcile. Jesus says, if you remember that he has something against you. Jesus doesn't say if they tell you they have something against you. Jesus says if you remember that they have something against you. If you become aware, it doesn't require them bringing it to your attention. It's if you become aware, it's your responsibility to restore the relationship. Tip number two, if they do bring it to your attention, don't defend yourself, okay? Look, if you've done nothing wrong, God knows, he'll vindicate you. And if you have done something wrong, then you need to repent and seek forgiveness. What you don't need to do is defend yourself. Defending yourself to somebody who thinks that you have hurt them is not going to change their perception of the matter. It's going to mean that you shut your ears and stop listening. So if somebody brings this to your attention that you've hurt them, don't defend yourself. Tip number three, take responsibility for your part in their pain. You might not be completely to blame. You might have had a good reason for doing what you did, but regardless, you contributed to their pain. You hurt them. Don't excuse. Don't explain. Just own what happened. Tip number four. Mistakes can hurt people just as much as sin. Mistakes can hurt people just as much as intentional attacks. Look, don't repent of a sin if there is no sin. But sometimes we hurt people through our carelessness or our ignorance. Maybe you didn't mean to hurt them, but maybe you should have been more careful. Tip number five, don't throw it back on them. They're bringing it to your attention that you've hurt them. Don't throw it back on them. Don't say, well, I think you're being a little too sensitive. Don't say, well, if you hadn't done that, I wouldn't have done. Don't say, well, that's not really what happened. This is gaslighting, and it's manipulative. An apology that makes somebody feel guilty for asking for an apology isn't an apology. Tip number six, admit fault and shut up. Look, if there truly is no blame for you to take, you can still prioritize the relationship and validate the other person by saying, I love you, I intended no harm, and I am sorry that my actions have affected you in this way. Look, in my mental image of myself, I am perfect and I make no mistakes. It is quite damaging to my self-image to admit that I might have done something that hurt someone else. This is uncomfortable. It makes us look weak. And it can be humiliating to admit that we were even partly wrong. But peacemakers are those for whom the glory of God and the good of others is more important than their comfort, their reputation, or their personal pride. Nobody said this was easy. But which is harder, admitting that we've hurt someone else or admitting that someone else hurt us? Speaking from my own experience, I have normally found it easier to admit blame than to admit pain. I've found it easier usually to admit blame than to admit pain. I mean, I make mistakes all the time. I sin far too often, so it's not really a surprise to learn that I've done something wrong. But to admit that someone has hurt me, that means becoming vulnerable in front of somebody who, at that moment, I believe to be my enemy. So, what do we do when others hurt us? We've already looked at what happens if we become aware that we've hurt somebody else. We prioritize that relationship and do everything we can to make it right. What do we do when someone else hurts us? Well, thankfully, once again, Jesus tells us. He gives us very clear instructions over in Matthew chapter 18, verses 15 through 17. Jesus says this, "If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and as a tax collector." Now, right now, I'd like to go ahead and address, I don't know if we have any students watching today. Any folks in middle school or high school? I don't know if we got any of you guys right now. But I'd like to address you right now. You see, you may not have been taught this. You may not have been taught Jesus' instructions here. I mean, heaven knows there's a whole bunch of adults out there that don't seem to have learned it. But here's how it goes. When someone says or does something that hurts you, you now have the responsibility to restore the relationship. All right, I'm gonna back up and say that again. When someone says or does something that hurts you, you now have the responsibility to restore the relationship. But what about them? They're the one who did it. Yes, they have the responsibility too, okay? We just dealt with that in a whole big section. But you are responsible for you. And Jesus says this is how you are supposed to handle it. And there are four steps. Four steps. Step number one, go to them alone and see if you can make it right. Or see if they can make it right, rather. Go to them alone and see if they'll make it right. That's step number one. Step number two, if they refuse, try again. But take one or two other people with you. Now, these should be people who are committed to the relationship, okay? Committed to the relationship between the two of you, okay? And they're also committed to Jesus. These are not just friends who are going to take your side. This is not ganging up on the other people. We're not trying to apply, you know, not trying to guilt them into anything or apply peer pressure to make them to admit to something they don't believe in. That's not what this is, okay? These are people who are committed to the relationship. They're committed to Jesus. In fact, if you're a young person listening, I would say make sure you take somebody more mature than you, okay? Possibly a parent. Now, step number three, if the person still won't listen, bring it to the attention of your pastor, who will then bring it to the attention of the church, who will together attempt to persuade the person to reconcile. And step number four, if the person persists and will not reconcile the relationship, then we just simply no longer consider them to be a follower of Christ. Now, if that sounds like a lot, that seems like a lot, all right, just focus on step number one. Step number one's hard enough. Go to the person alone. If somebody hurts you, you go to them alone. That's hard enough to do because you're going to want to complain to somebody else first. And the second you do that, you are no longer behaving like a peacemaker. And parents, neither are we. I know I just spoke to the students, but let me talk to us parents for a second. You see, this isn't something we can do for our kids. But if we're teaching them to follow Christ, it is something that we will teach them to do for themselves. But that's not our first instinct, is it? When we find out that somebody has hurt our kid, we declare war. If not literally, at least in our hearts, we declare war on the other kid, we declare war on their family, and we declare war on the pastor or teacher who let it happen. Peace is not the goal. Vengeance is. Vindication is. Now, don't get lost in my word pictures, okay? What I am saying is what we all know to be true, and that is this. Minor incidents between children can become major rifts between adults. Minor tiffs between kids can become major rifts between adults. And I know. My kids have been hurt. My kids have been treated unfairly. My kids have been misrepresented. And when that happened, I guarantee you, I was not thinking rationally. I was not thinking objectively. I wasn't even thinking as a Christian. In those moments, I responded exactly how my culture says every parent should respond. And that's like this. Protect! Protect your kids! Stand up for your kids! But while protection is a God-given instinct, it's not all he's called us to do. Not exactly. I mean, of course, we make sure they wear their seatbelts. We make sure they go to the dentist. We make sure they don't play in the street. We do all the good things that good parents do. But God has not just called us to protect our kids. He's called us to prepare them. Life will treat our kids unfairly. And we can't always run to their side to demand that somebody else do better. We have to prepare our kids for what to do when someone hurts them. We have to prepare them to respond to when they are confronted with the fact that they have hurt someone else. Oh my goodness, if I had a dollar for every time some parent has said, well, my kid would never do that. Oh please, yes, your kid would. You did, I've done it. Yes, your kid would, they're kids. We need to teach our kids what to do when someone hurts them. And how to respond when they are confronted with the fact that they have hurt someone else. And the question is, are we preparing them to follow Christ and live as peacemakers? I say this because we're now facing a generation of adults whose parents didn't prepare them. We are living with a generation of adults who now demand that everyone else change to accommodate them. And if they don't, we cancel them. You change to accommodate me, and if you don't, I cancel you. How many memes have I seen about, you know, don't cross the ocean for somebody who wouldn't cross the street for you? That's a great attitude. Thank God Jesus didn't follow it. Look, you can sit there and you can say, well, you know what, Aaron? I mean, shouldn't I teach my kids to be true to themselves? Yeah, sure. If there is no God but Disney and Pixar is his prophet. Think about what that means, teaching our children to be true to themselves. I mean, I'm messed up. I'm broken. I need a savior. Why should I be true to the guy who needs saving? I want to be true to the guy who saved me. And his calling is for me to change and become more like him and less like my broken self. The question is, am I going to show my kids how to live this way? Or am I willing to allow the actions of immature children to blow up my relationship with brothers and sisters in Christ? Now, lest you think this message is all about parents and kids, it's not. You see, while I have seen adults acting like children in every ministry I've ever been a part of, the place where peacemaking fails to show up the most often is in marriages. Conflict is part of marriage. What makes the difference between marriages that thrive and marriages that die is the ability to make peace. You see, in today's culture, we marry someone who affirms our vision of ourselves and we call it love. But love is, by its very nature, self-sacrificing. And unfortunately, within a very short time, we discover that the other person has priorities of their own that don't necessarily line up with ours, and we discover they're not quite as impressed with us as we are with ourselves. The couples that make it are those who are able to submit their own interests to the good of the other person and the success of the relationship. And though Christians sometimes fail here, Christians have a better shot than everyone else does because we have a model. We have Christ. We have Christ who laid aside his own rights and privileges and came to us. We sure weren't going to him. Sacrificing himself in love to make us children of God. He is the Prince of Peace. He is the ultimate peacemaker. Blessed are the peacemakers. Why? Because they will be called children of God. And why will they be called that? Because they see that in Christ, we are a family. And they are willing to take responsibility for that relationship. And that's really what this all boils down to. You see, whether someone else hurt you or you hurt them or there's just something not quite right between the two of you, you are willing to be the first one to make peace. That's who a peacemaker is. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. If I'm going to be a peacemaker, it doesn't matter if they hurt me or if I hurt them or if there's just something not quite right. The peacemaker is the one who's willing to be the first one to make peace. It will be uncomfortable. You may look weak doing it. It might be humiliating, but you will be following Christ. The scriptures teach us this in Romans 15, verses 1 through 6. We who are strong have the obligation to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Let each of us please his neighbor for his good to build him up. For Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, quote, the reproaches of those who reproached you fell on me. For whatever was written in the former days was written for our instruction, that through endurance and through the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. So may the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another, in accordance with Jesus Christ, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Church, may the glory of God and the good of others so outweigh our own comforts, reputations, and pride that people see the way we live and they conclude they must be children of God. Do you have peace with God today? That's my first question. And if you don't, let me assure you with the good news that God has done everything to make peace with you. He has sent his son to die on a cross and rise again from the dead, and he welcomes you. He invites you, turn from your sin and receive the free gift of Jesus Christ. And you can have peace with God. Maybe you say, Aaron, that does describe me. I would call myself a follower of Jesus Christ. Well, if that's the case, then I'm asking you, do you have peace with others? Are you aware that somebody might have something against you? Are you aware of the possibility that you might have caused harm or hurt to someone else? Has somebody else hurt you? The week is before you. You know what to do. Right now, ask God to search your heart and then ask him to give you the strength to be a peacemaker. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for your word. Lord, you've given us a high calling, a difficult calling, in fact, an impossible one without the strength of Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray that if there's anybody who doesn't have peace with you or peace within themselves, Lord, that they would find that by your grace and your name through Jesus. And if there are those who are watching this who, at this moment, do not quite have peace with others, I pray that you would convict them of that and then give them the strength and grace and humility to pursue peace as children of God. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.